Diamo veramente un caldo benvenuto Martin Eberhard.
Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful and committed people can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. This quote from Margaret Mead captures the idea of Silicon Valley innovation and has been one of my mottos throughout most of my career. I started off my career as an engineer working for a Silicon Valley technology company making, well, boring computer products. I left that company some years later and started another company making, well, boring networking products. After that, I founded two more companies, both of them making much more interesting products, and then I spent a little bit of time at one of the world's largest corporations. I'd like to tell you the story of a couple of these companies as a way of illustrating some concepts of innovation that I've learned through my career. Okay, so when I was done making boring networking products, I wanted to do something interesting, and this was the first concept that seemed clear for innovation. In those days, I had an interest in mobile computing when mobile computing was just becoming possible. I've always had a passion for usability, and I've had a strong interest in books. I was also aware of some technological changes that had come along. Batteries had finally gotten good enough that handheld electronics were possible. Screen technology had gotten just good enough that one could imagine reading a book on a screen. And low-power electronics made it possible to put some real computing power in your hand for the first time. With these ideas, we created a thing called the Rocket eBook, which was arguably the first electronic book. Now, people will say there were electronic books before the Rocket book, and that's true, but these were not exactly books. These were really calculators with funny screens. Nobody would ever consider reading on such a thing. The Rocket book, in contrast, was optimized for reading. It had a highly readable screen, a simple user interface, a long enough battery life that you could really read on it, and could hold a large number of books, was lightweight and low cost. We designed this product to work within the very old-fashioned book industry. We used a web-based distribution, and we developed a very secure encryption system for delivering digital content on the internet. This was very important in these days because this was at the time that Napster had come along and had basically destroyed the music industry. And the book industry was terrified that the same thing would happen to them. We had to prove to them that with cryptography, their profitable books would not be stolen. As a result, we got the content, the books, from most of the small publishers in the US and all of the major publishers, and we began distributing throughout the United States and began also distributing in Europe. We raised a total of $27 million for the course of this company, and we shipped the product on schedule in 1998. In 1999, at the Christmas season of 1999, we were approached by a company called Gemstar with an offer to buy our company. This was a surprise to us, but we also felt that we were living in a bubble in Silicon Valley, and we decided to accept this offer to buy the company and sold the company in January of 2000. This turned out to be magical timing. It was, I think, March of 2000 when the dot-com bubble collapsed, and almost all investments in Silicon Valley wound up being worth nothing. We provided one of the few profitable exits in that time. Although the Rocket book is gone, its impact can be felt. Most of the electronic books available today are based on technology that we developed. About the time that I left Nuvomedia, it was when the Segway was introduced. And I remember the Segway and looking at this piece of amazing technology and saying, this is really a cool piece of technology. But on the other hand, it looked to me to be a solution looking for a problem. And as much as the Segway seemed like a cool piece of technology, it didn't look like it was solving anybody's real problems. I thought about this, and I thought about my concept of doing something interesting, and it seemed that really what we should be doing is something worthwhile. In those days, I was becoming very concerned about global warming. I was concerned about American dependence on foreign oil. I've always had an interest in cars, and I still have a passion for usability. I thought a lot about oil consumption, and one of the concepts of oil consumption in the United States that seemed unique was that this was an idea that appealed to both sides of the American political spectrum. On the one hand, on the left, people were concerned about global warming, and then on the right, people were concerned about the implications of our dependence on foreign oil. I used to put this slide up in presentations and say that to the American audience, you would either relate to one of these pictures and the other one would make you angry, or the other way, it doesn't matter. Both are a good reason for us not to be consuming oil anymore. So I thought very hard about oil, and particularly its use in cars. I thought, what else could we use? I was not originally an enthusiast of electric cars or of any other technology, but rather just trying to find a way to use less oil. So I looked at, of course, electric cars. I looked at biodiesel. I looked at ethanol, I looked at fuel cells, I looked at really every other kind of technology I could find. And the way I compared them was this. I looked at what is the net resource consumption for each of these technologies per kilometer driven, and for that matter, what is the net carbon dioxide emissions per kilometer. And as you can probably guess, I concluded that electric cars were by far the best choice. So, one of the things that people bring up about electric cars is, don't they just move the problem upstream? I still have to make the electricity to power the car somehow, and when I make that electricity, I'll still be producing emissions, I'll still be consuming energy. That's a fair question, and the answer to that requires a little bit of math. Okay, so in the year 2002, a typical gasoline-powered car consumed about 9 liters of gasoline per 100 kilometers. And it's known what is the energy content of gasoline. It's about 950 watt-hours, 9,500 watt-hours per liter. And we know the efficiency of taking crude oil and converting that into gasoline. And so you can compute this, and you can come to the conclusion that this typical gasoline car consumed about 1,000 watt-hours of crude oil per kilometer driven. In those days, the best car you could buy would be a hybrid, and that was about 5.7 liters per 100 kilometers. And if you do the math, that's about 670 watt-hours of crude oil per kilometer. So now we can compare that to an electric car. Okay, let's just use an electric car such as my own and produce the electricity for that using the worst possible way, using a very old-fashioned coal-powered power plant. Okay, so the car consumes about 155 watt-hours per kilometer. You can calculate in the charging efficiency and the efficiency of moving electricity onto the grid. And finally, that 29% efficient coal-fired power plant. And with that, you can calculate that the electric car consumes about 645 watt-hours of that coal per kilometer driven. And of course, this is the worst way to make electricity. Even still burning coal, but using a modern 45% efficient generating plant, that car is much better. It's at now 490 watt-hours per kilometer. And still, coal is not a very good way to make electricity. If instead we make that using natural gas, using a modern combined cycle natural gas plant, this car consumes only 328 watt-hours per kilometer driven. All right, that's a bunch of math. And if you compare these to each other, what you see is this. If you make the electricity in the worst possible way, that car uses about the same energy as the best possible way you could do it with gasoline. And if you try a little bit harder, still using fossil fuels, the electric car is about half of the energy consumption as the best case gasoline car. And I'd like to point out that you don't actually have to make that electricity from fossil fuels at all. And as an example, this is my own car. And that's the roof of my house. And that solar panel on the roof of my house produces the electricity for my car and for my house. I use no carbon fuel, and I have no CO2 emissions.